something like 4 to 5 hours a week in watching the video as well as doing the assignments. So let's see the motivation for this course itself. So the first thing is, many advances in the industry as well as scientific advances have been possible because of the use of computation. So computers are ubiquitous, you can see it everywhere now, and this has actually made many, many fields leapfrog or improve quite a bit. There are very few projects which are complex and yet not use computers. So another way to put that is, almost every real world project out there uses computers, be it from designing a bicycle or an airplane to designing clothes. Pretty much everything uses computers nowadays, and the general purpose computer is probably the best example for a digital system. So we have used this in various forms, your PCs, your laptops and so on are all general purpose computers. This is probably the best example of a digital system. So the course is titled Digital Circuits and Digital Systems. So we will learn both the circuit side of it as well as the system side of it. So there are several other examples, as I mentioned. For example, digital telephones, switching exchanges, displays, calculators, video games, pretty much everything that you see around you is does have some digital component or the other. All these computers use the same concepts that we will present in the class. So the fundamentals for a digital system is something that you will learn in this course. We may not reach the level of complexity of designing a complete chip or a computer in this course, but the fundamentals that you learn here will help you understand how these systems are built. So let's take a small look at what a digital system is as opposed to what an analog system is. So first thing is, in a digital system, information is represented in some discrete form rather than continuous form. We will see this as we go along, but in some sense the discrete nature will tell you that we will look at logic values 0 and 1 as opposed to a voltage which is 0 volts to 5 volts or 0 volts to 3 volts and so on, or any range in between. We will usually stick to two values, 0 and 1. So that is a form of discretization. We will see several other forms of discretization as we go along. One thing is, the analog systems are usually based on continuous forms. There is something continuously happening in an analog system. So if you take for example audio cassettes, so probably you have seen this, some of you may have used it. So the audio cassettes is a classical example of analog system. So it records a continuous analog signal, and you can however take this continuous analog signal and sample it at frequent intervals or at regular intervals and get discrete forms. So this is an example of a sinusoid, where I want to show what a continuous system is versus what a discrete system is. So in the x-axis you see time, and in the y-axis you see amplitude, and a continuous waveform at every time point you will see that there is a certain voltage or an amplitude for this signal. In a discrete world, what you would do is you will sample this at regular intervals. So for example, let's say I sampled this waveform only at these intervals, at this location and this location and so on, I'll have only 4 values, that's all, right? So when I have 4 values, it's not good enough though. So if I sample here, this is let's say +2.5, I sample here, it's, let's say it's -2.5. So it'll come to me as though I have only 4 values, +2.5, -2.5, +2.5 and -2.5. So many times this is not enough. So one thing that you can do is actually interpolate between these times. So this red waveform that you see here is interpolation between these points. So if I sampled here and sampled here and interpolated the values in between, similarly between this sample and this sample I have interpolated the value in between and so on. So what you get is a triangular waveform, which is a very, very crude approximation to the sinusoid that we saw. So this is an example of discretization. We can do better. If we take more samples and interpolate between those and connect it, so for example here the green waveform is like that. We have taken more samples, between the samples we have interpolated, and what you get is this green waveform. We can see that it is already closer to the blue waveform rather than the red waveform. So this is how discretization works. You do not have to really know the voltage levels at each and every time point from here to here. Instead, we need to know the voltage levels, let's say at these points alone, and everywhere in between we can interpolate and say this is the value. So this is one way in which an analog signal can be sampled. So you capture the input which is an analog input and save it as a discrete set of values, and if you want to reproduce it, you do interpolation or some such thing. So let's look at the advantages of digital systems. Digital computers actually offer a lot of flexibility than analog computers. So the programmability of digital computers is quite good, and this is one of the main reasons why digital computers took off starting from the 50s or 60s. Then there are several other important aspects of digital systems. It's fairly easier, it's relatively easier to design high speed digital circuits than designing analog circuits. Analog circuits, it's still a bit of a black magic that goes in sometimes into analog circuits, and to be an experienced analog designer, you will have to do a lot of courses, you have to do a lot of you have to get a lot of experience before you can even start producing anything which is useful in a lab, let alone commercially viable product. Whereas in a digital circuit, it's fairly easy to understand the fundamentals and fairly easy to do many of these exercises in your lab or build a system yourself. Then the third bullet is the numeric information that you have is usually represented with a much higher precision and range with digital circuits than with analog signals. And in terms of reproducibility, digital signals, if you design a circuit properly, given the same inputs, it will produce the same output every single time, as opposed to analog circuits where there are other external factors which can influence how they work. So you might have seen that over time an old radio may start behaving in a different way, or even cassettes, if you play over and over, they start decaying and so on. So some of these aging and other things are problems with analog circuits, whereas with digital circuit you don't really have a problem like that usually. Then a few more bullet points in favor of digital circuits. So information storage and retrieval are much easier to do with digital circuits. Many of these circuits have built-in error protection, so these circuits can have errors, but there are various mechanisms to detect if there are errors and even correct them, and this is a very useful thing to have in digital circuits. Miniaturization is easier with digital circuits than with analog circuits. What that means is you can make smaller and smaller chips which can provide a lot of functionality by using digital techniques. All of these, however, come with a catch. It's not that digital circuits is everything and you can do everything in digital world itself. The biggest problem is the world is not discrete, it's an analog world, right? The what you see as my video or what you hear as my speech or anything that you perceive, touch, smell, sense and so on, are all continuous signals. Whereas the computer is a digital system, or the circuits that you design may be digital systems. So one way to deal with this problem is to design inputs which will convert the analog input signal into a digital signal, then process the whole thing digitally, and when you produce output, you convert the digital signal back into an analog signal. So this is a very nice and interesting way to look at real world things. So you deal with the analog signals in the external world, but you capture them as digital signals, process all of them using digital systems, and when you produce the output back, convert it to analog systems. So for the inputs to be converted to digital form, we use what are called ADCs, or analog to digital converters, and when we produce the outputs, we use what are called DACs, or digital to analog converters. So digital DACs and ADCs are not in the scope of this course. You will probably learn it elsewhere. If you are an electronic student or a EE student or even CSE students, learn it in other courses. So let's see where the digital systems are used. They are used everywhere. I said the word I used is ubiquitous. It's used everywhere. You see them in cell phones, in rockets, in televisions, toasters, ovens, F1 cars, whatnot. Right? In everything that you see around, you see some form of digital circuit or the other. Even if you don't see them from the external world, they have electronic components inside. So if you go and ask your parents what kind of watch they had when they were in their teens, they'll probably tell you that their watches were completely analog, and so on. However, nowadays we have digital.